project permit for the shed at a different location. And then Glenn asked him to move it closer or down towards the back of the house more because of some sort of building code. So when, between the time you saw it and I saw it, I think it had moved. Also, when I measured out its original spot, it was more than 50 feet, 60-something feet away from the wetland. So I'm not sure how far it moved.
It's right here.
It moved a lot as far as I can see.
Yeah.
You put it.
Yeah.
I think if there wasn't grading involved, I think even where it is, a minor project could be appropriate. But with the grading, I think that should be included in the same RDA.
An RDA is appropriate for that. So the grading is near the proposed shed? Is it in that corner?
The grading is at this point here.
Okay.
At 9 by 9 sections.
Okay. Oh, so remove soil, not add soil?
Right.
And then add retaining wall.
It's a point right here.
Oh, okay, gotcha. Yeah, pictures are great. Yeah.
Right here. It is the existing fence.
Gotcha. That's the proposed.
That corner right there, it's that, see that triangle?
Yeah, it's raised.
It's raised, and I just want it behind the shed, I just want to keep it all nice and level.
So that the water doesn't drain to your shed and rot it? Is that what you're saying? Okay.
And I can walk behind it and put stuff behind there and have it, you know.
Gotcha.
Which is also to be graded down.
Yep, yeah.
I'm sorry, what about the wheelbarrow?
No.
So you're not looking at the equipment? So he's got a hiding place for his ladders and wheelbarrow.
Okay, so this,
yeah, that's
10 feet, you're taking out 16 inches of soil.
Yeah, that's when it goes down towards the grade.
Right, and then what about in this area, how much soil?
That's 4 feet.
It's like a house I'd like to have.
So that's 48 inches?
Yeah, 48 inches by 9 by 9 area, corner, that'd be removed. And then that 10-foot area, by 16 inches, that'll be, that's to bring it to grade.
So just to be clear, excavation in this corner won't cause erosion toward the resource area. If anything, it'll erode, it could erode back towards his lawn.
That corner drains right now to the resource area.
It's kind of up on a hill.
Yeah.
An upland hill, yeah.
The resource area drains, everything comes off a hill, up a property upland, and then everything from the yard drains to the resource area.
Oh, okay, okay. I apologize, I should have seen it in person. From the picture, it looks like the whole area behind this high area looks high.
It is.
It's a section behind it, yeah.
But it sounds like he's cutting into a slope before it hits its height?
Yes.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Yes, it does.
So anything eroded from there will drain away from there? No? Okay.
It's going down this way.
Okay, okay.
It's a kind of a wetish meadow back here, and then there's a stream or a swale, and it goes that way.
I understand. Okay.
This one here shows the
Type of fence.
The landscape timber.
Yeah.
Just that, like, 9 by 9 section there, and then it'll taper down this way.
Okay.
So blends into.
Is that the shed you had to build?
That's the shed I want to build, yeah.
That's pretty.
Is it a prefab? Is it a prefab?
No, I'm gonna build it.
But you have a design, obviously.
I'm gonna build it, huh?
But you have a design, that's where you got this picture from?
Yeah.
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 Oh, yeah. That's exactly what I want on there. I don't want it to look like a little shed, I want it to look nice.
Is it on sonotubes?
4 foot landscape timber.
Are you using sonotubes?
4 foot taper down.
To support the shed?
So what is the? I was thinking of that on all points.
If you're not gonna use those, what else were you thinking of?
What's that?
What else, what are you?
Well, on the building permit, I was gonna put it on crushed stone.
Could be 20.
And that
Creates a 24.
Okay.
So either way, the way I have in the building permit is to put it on, I have compact way, crushed stone.
Okay. So a question I have, I'm just gonna start off and ask other people to just jump in. Is so the landscape timbers that you're putting, the 8x8s, is, can I assume, kind of, since there's, it looks like there's like three stacks of 8x8s, that's like 24 inches of soil being held back there?
Right.
Okay. I just wanted to get a sense of that.
The high point area is 4 feet, and then it tapers right down.
Oh, you're gonna, okay, so that's more cartoon kind of.
Yeah, so it's,
so this goes up 4 feet.
Right, and then it's a small high section, and it tapers right down.
Yeah,
that's why I'm gonna step the fence up like that, because I don't wanna do too much there.
Does this need clearance with building, Chuck? It's, don't, isn't like a structured wall, don't we have a minimum threshold for a retaining wall, and isn't it 4 feet?
I thought it was 3 feet. Is it 4 feet?
I think it's 3 feet.
Wasn't it 3 feet?
Yeah, three to four.
I can't remember. I think it's three.
It's a fence of 6 and a wall is probably 4. It's probably 4.
4. That, I mean, that's not our requirement, but that's building department. Or no, wait, it's in our.
Yeah, that's a retaining wall. It's 4 feet. And then you would have to have an engineer drawing, but that's not our view.
Yeah, okay. Just mention it, builder beware.
I will.
All right.
Okay.
Well, thanks for this additional information. I definitely get a pretty clear picture of what's going on. Is there any other questions from commission members about the project?
Yeah, there's concerns. So I see that it's 55 feet from the wetland there.
From the shed?
From the corner of the shed.
Shed.
Yeah.
That seems a bit right. We didn't measure it, but that seems.
I thought it came right up to the, kind of where the fence was. A little bit further forward. I know that I'm a little more aggressive.
You mean the resource area?
Yeah.
Well, in that corner, that is a resource area.
Yeah,
that's
I just see that, like, the circle.
Even
but
if,
down
you know
at
what?
The bottom, you're right, the resource area comes probably within
right to the fence, yeah. Where
20 feet or so of the fence.
Even if it did, he's still, like, isn't he still 55 feet? Or?
I know there's a hill there. It's going to be basically at the hill, at where that's going up.
You're just saying it comes in further here, closer.
I came up closer to where the fence was, but
yeah,
not
mine.
Closer going towards the where the shed was.
Right.
At the east end of the fence, the resource area does come fairly close to the fence. But up there at the hill, it's quite a distance away.
I agree. Yeah, I agree.
Okay. Any other
questions?
I'm
just trying to figure out, and I'd welcome the others that were on the site visit. So that drainage is going to come off that hill and come toward the fence, and then I guess run on the resource side of the fence and eventually make it down into that resource area down at the east end of the fence. Is that what you think is going to happen?
Yes.
So the drainage probably will not come into the yard, my guess, or not much of it anyway.
Unless it weeps through the fence, but that's probably, if that's a tight, if, unless it weeps through the fence, but if
mm-hmm.
if it's a tight
that's my
connection.
Well, really, to make it, you know, to be able to have it flat.
Is there a ledge back there?
That one big rock.
Yeah.
That's a rock. Those rocks in the corner, I'm going to use them, put them over here.
Right, there was that one
right
real big
stump
one
there.
Right around in there somewhere by the stump, right.
Over here, you're right.
Excuse me.
It's over
one.
Here.
It's over
right,
here.
It's like right here.
What
it's
about
like,
in the here and the, you don't
well,
know?
Well, I didn't touch anything, you know. If it is, I'll just keep it the way it is then. I'll have to deal with it. I mean, I don't think I want to go and blast ledge out of there at all for this reason. At all, you know, if that's what it is, I'll landscape it somehow, make it look nice. You know, that's what if that's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Did you have any other?
Well, if there is ledge there, would you be moving your shed back? out of it.
I'd have to do something like that, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
If you're going to change, if we approve this and you're going to change it, just check, let them know, and, I mean, do we do minor plan changes for RDAs, or?
We'd have to change it somehow, it was pretty minor, I could just.
Just add a note to the file, or?
And 5 feet here or there, it's not going to be a big deal.
No. If it moves closer to the resource, we're definitely going to, you know, want to be alerted. You know, if you're pulling it back, we also want to be alerted, but it's a little bit less of a concern, you know, from our standpoint. When you put in the fence, are there going to be, are you going to need to cut any trees or bushes or shrubs, or? It all goes on existing lawn? And those fences are going to go into, you're going to drop sonotubes and just posts and, I'm just wondering.
Only on the gates, you know.
Okay.
The pressure field, you can dig into the soil and.
Okay.
Pack it with stone dust.
Okay.
To keep it stiff, rather than use cement.
Keep it protected, yeah, okay.
Then put on a little bit.
Okay.
You fill it in, so you get good rain.
Okay.
Or even crush stone.
Yeah.
Okay, any other questions or comments from the commission?
I do think we're going to need some erosion control measures down at the other end, just during all that excavation. If you get a big rainstorm with that's going on, it could be a mess.
Mm. Mm.
This is just during the construction period, then you take it up once you're done.
Yeah.
Okay. There's a lot of soil.
Okay. Any questions or comments from the applicant or the public? No? All right. Hearing none, I'll entertain a vote. Motion and a vote.
Move we issue a negative determination for Larch Lane.
31
Larch Lane. And with the conditions that if the location of the shed changes, he has to come back, and that we provide in the approval, substantial erosion control at the east end of the property.
Okay. Is there a second?
I second.
All those in favor? Opposed? None? Abstained? None? Okay.
Should I sign the order as amended?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Let's
the
do
order
it.
Or the determination.
For all of you folks that came in, did you sign in? I don't think we said anything about
thank
that.
Thank you. Yeah.
Oh, we signed it.
Yeah.
It's an attendance sheet at the door.
Right.
Usually, when please
we
sign in.
We should have said something. We're sorry.
Yeah. We usually say it at the beginning of the notices of intent when I'm opening,
yeah.
Reading that script.
But sorry.
Thanks. Thanks for bringing that up. Okay, let's get to the continued. All right, we have a continued notice of intent for 0 Main Street. Where's my? Here we go. Okay. Going to reopen the public hearing for notice of intent DEP number 270-0643, 0 Main Street, map 51, lot 95. Mr. Ahern, that is This hearing is now being reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40 as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 5.7. The hearing will be conducted as follows. The applicant will present their proposal. The commission will receive reports from its administrator, technical advisors, and other town departments. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. The public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. Please give your name and address before your comments and or questions are presented. And as was mentioned earlier, sign in if you haven't already at the sign-in sheet at the door. And at this point, we're going to introduce ourselves, starting with Chuck.
Chuck Tarone, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Ryan Sullivan, Vice Chair.
Anika Scanlon, Chair.
Jamie Maughan.
Rebecca Longley.
Judy Lodjack, Recording.
Okay, thank you. Is there somebody from Zero Main? Or?
Just to catch everybody up,
yeah.
I sent this out well before the 4th of July, and I only received comments by Mr. Flynn, and I incorporated them into
the current.
What we're looking at now.
Did the applicant or Jack Sullivan get a copy?
Yes.
Did they have any comments?
No, they were fine with it.
Okay. I have some questions.
Go ahead.
Give us a page. Page 15, number 5. Last two words, Mass Oliver.
Oh, that's a mapping program? It's an online version of MassGIS. It's like a user-friendly, web-driven platform.
Probably doesn't say MassGIS.
But it is called Oliver.
Item 5.
I thought it might be GIS.
Yeah,
Oliver is online something viewer. It's an abbreviation.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
Oh, so it's an acronym.
Yeah.
So it might be all capitalized.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then number 8, I just second line, dry wells. Yeah, 2 500-gallon concrete dry wells.
Okay.
And page 16, number 5, I did see that you got the orange construction fence on the property line between 0 Main, capital M, and 1257. Yeah, that's it for me.
Okay, do we have a motion to?
Is it public meeting still open?
Yeah.
I just reopened it.
I believe someone's in the audience that might have something to say.
Great.
I was just trying to hear what the update was. The blue flags were moved, Chuck, they moved those.
Okay,
Paul Walsh, 532 Pearl Street, sorry.
Thank you, you're in a butter.
I am a butter.
Yeah, okay.
So at the last meeting we were asked if were the flags moved, and Jack did move the flags. And so
in the field.
They are moved.
So the two trees that are directly next to 7A flag, are those trees touchable? Are they being, I just see that they're marked, are they in the buffer zone, or are they?
Which flag?
7A.
Near
7A.
No trees within 25 feet of that flag are going to be touched.
Okay. And again, those are just denoted just for purposes of.
You mean the trees being marked?
Yeah,
you mean?
Being marked, yes.
I'm not sure why
for
the
survey.
Trees
for
are marked. Oh, they may have. We asked them to put trees on their lot on the plan.
So Jack.
So is that what happened?
Jack's going through and marking trees. He's marking them for two reasons. So he doesn't, you know, remark them.
Double
so
count them.
There's a lot of marks out there that doesn't mean anything. It just means that he's already surveyed that tree in. So I think that's probably why a lot more mark than is on the plan.
A couple thoughts. I think that's a difficult lot. I think after a number of back and forth, we have a pretty good plan that protects the resource, but I think there are a lot of things that could go wrong. So so I would just ask Chuck for you to make frequent visits out there and make sure none of the trees that we work to protect get inadvertently cut down, and to make sure the barriers are in the right place and so on and so forth.
Okay.
I think you, don't you usually just go, once the erosion control is established, you go out and walk it anyway?
We do a pre-activity meeting.
Yeah.
And that's to establish the fact that things are installed correctly. So they don't even move forward unless, or I don't even sign the permit unless the erosion control is installed correctly.
Yeah.
Usually and I pull on that just to make sure. House like this, you know, it's going to be top-notch erosion control. So go through that. And then once they establish the construction entrance and start clearing, I'll look after that point. So check for trees, check for erosion control, so that the market trees are going to cut down, as long as that's what's on the plan,
and
allow
that fence
them to go. And they give a schedule of what the construction is going to be, and I ask them to note milestones and, you know, foundation, tree,
right,
things like that. So I know when to go out. And
good.
This, we've worked with this gentleman before, and he does make calls to update his schedule. So
okay.
Which, you mean the contractor?
The contractor, yeah.
Who is the contractor?
It's Ahern. I don't forgot his first name or his last name.
Robert.
Robert Ahern. And he did those three on Main Street that were pretty close together.
Right. Mm-hmm. The ones almost across the street.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
If there's any blasting that goes on or anything like that that they uncover as they get into it, will the abutters be notified of that, or how
that's,
that?
That's the fire department that takes care of that, and their notifications I'm not aware of. So you might ask the fire department what the procedure is. So
there is some chance that they could go in, start this project, there is blasting required, let's just say, I'm presuming here, presumption. And I might not get any notice that all of a sudden there could be a beep and a blast, or?
The easiest way to answer that is to say you're not going to get notice on blasting from the conservation office.
Okay.
Where it comes from, I don't know, or even if you get notice.
Do you need a permit from the fire department to blast?
Oh, yes.
You need an approval, and they put, I forgot the name of the thing, but they put it on the closest building to check out for
like a seismometer or something?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, we don't anticipate blasting, though. It could
happen.
Well,
I don't, I, we have no way,
times,
we have no way to know.
With the sewage that needs to be pumped.
But they moved it, they changed it.
We don't know. Check with
I asked George.
Check
and
with the fire department.
I did talk to Greg, the chief of the fire department, and it's really under their to control that.
And last question: all the equipment will be contained within sort of the buffer zone. They can't come outside of that area. Any equipment or what? Is there any restriction as far as that goes?
It sounds like you have a plan, right? So on the plan, there's a limit of work line.
Yep.
They can't work beyond that. We do not let them
store equipment beyond that.
Oh,
and
we have to modify that, but we don't let them to overnight any equipment in the 100-foot buffer unless there's no other spot, which there isn't. So as far away as possible is where they're going to be putting their equipment.
But it will be within the limit of work line.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting seeing how they do build this, because they are restricted in space within the lot itself. But, you know, it's on them to keep with the limit of work lines that they've put on this plan.
They may have to take it out every day.
So, yeah, they may have to remove all equipment every day, or most
right.
equipment every day. I don't know.
How does that get required?
No.
It doesn't get required. It's up to them.
I'm
saying they might have to.
It's up to them to work out operationally how they're going to make it
happen.
Kind
of how I think about it is the space where the house driveway is going is fine to park on.
Mm-hmm.
Just put it as far away as possible. And, you know, this is going to be a disturbed area.
Right.
So.
Right. Okay. Any more questions?
No.
Okay. Any other questions from commission members? No? Is there a motion to approve this order of conditions as drafted?
we already did, didn't we?
Okay, all those in favor? Opposed? Abstain?
No.
Okay. All right.
Oh, we need to close the hearing.
I move we close the hearing for Zero Main Street.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. All right, we're done with Zero Main Street. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Anybody have a working stapler?
No stapler.
Here's one.
Yeah, does it work? I got two in front of me, but, oh, good, thank you. All right. Okay, let's get to 306 Main Street. So we're going to reopen the public hearing for DEP number 270-0641, 306 Main Street, map 11, lot 22. Mr. Simpson, welcome. It's now being reopened, being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 5.7. The applicant will present the latest in his proposal. The commission will discuss the matter. Commission will address questions and or comments to the applicant. The public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. Please give your name and address before your comments and or questions are presented. And at this point, let's introduce ourselves, starting with Julie.
Julie Roger, recording secretary.
What? Rebecca Longwood. Sorry. What?
I didn't the changes that you said to when I come around, can you mark them on that?
Jamie Moore.
Nika Scanlon, Chair.
Brian Sullivan, Vice Chair.
Michael Holman.
Chuck Tirone, Conservation Administrator.
Okay, we have before us a July 1, the latest I have, was a July 1 revised plan and narrative. Did you want to say anything about it, or?
Conversation with Chuck. He's not here tonight, so as far
That's
as
right.
I would know anything
good
to add to it.
Okay.
The parking changed somewhat, if I remember.
A little bit.
George recommended angling the how the we park as opposed to straight in, and then we switched the handicapped to the same spot, just switched it around. And then there was some engineering that we had to work out.
Okay, does tilting, angling those spots puts it right at the 35 buffer, doesn't it? Or did they,
angling,
from the previous plan.
The angling actually removed it.
Removed it from the 35.
Yeah.
That helps.
Yeah, it gets the front edge out.
Yeah. Okay, I don't see any major problem with those plan changes. Just looking at it, I can't remember. I'm hoping somebody else knows these plans a little better than I do. But remind me where the snow storage is on the lot.
It's behind the dumpster.
It's behind
the
dumpster.
Back right-hand side. Is
oh, I see it. I see it.
We don't put any snow around.
No, we don't.
Yeah,
just a little bit. And I thought I recalled if that snow storage area sort of got maxed, that you're gonna remove.
Yeah, I have a contract with the landscaper to come and remove it out.
Okay. Any other questions, or those are my questions. Any other
Where
questions?
Where do you stand with CPDC?
I'm approved.
You're approved.
Yeah.
Okay. So these plans are the ones that they approved.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, the last revision was per CPDC decision.
Okay.
There was just a couple issues with engineering that Jack had worked out with George.
That site is a mess right now. It's got all the equipment on it for the construction.
Yeah.
Is that for the road construction?
Yeah.
It's a staging area?
Yeah.
Yeah, they asked me to, and so we had to put some fencing up, which I didn't have up, but Yeah, it was more to, they asked me if they could keep it there and, you know, help out with the project a little quicker, because they were getting moved from Zani's location.
Yeah, convenient. I was looking at the comments, I was just curious, so the lower drain, item five on the comments, it says lower drainage system by 6 inches throughout to allow more cover over drainage pipes in paved areas and to allow greater freeboard in the rain gardens. Just tell me what freeboard is.
I'm not too sure what the freeboard, but.
Does anybody know what the, what that?
Freeboard is the amount of space between the water level and the top of the wall.
It's protection from overflow.
Okay, because I know the depth to water there is pretty shallow.
Drainage basins generally have about a foot of freeboard.
Okay. I don't do drainage engineering. Okay, any other questions from commission members or Chuck?
You know, I still think that I don't think we should not move forward, but I would like to still work on this operation and maintenance plan. I just thought that some of the stuff, it just needed to have a little more information in it. I would like this, for instance, I would like an annual report not only sent to the engineering department, but to the conservation commission also. And some other things which, you know, how are they going to take care of the snow storage area in the spring? It says sweep that. At what point do they determine how much snow, what constitutes, a full lot of snow? You're just going to keep pushing on it or what? And I'm sure that's not what's going to happen, but to just maybe just tighten up some of these points a little bit. Again, it's not a reason to not continue on, but.
Mm-hmm. No, I agree. I mean, it might be helpful. I think it would be helpful to put in there snow plowing, you know, some mention about, you know, excess snow to be removed. Just to keep it out of the resource area and keep it from adding, you know, street debris and pollutants and salts and to the resource area, you know, just kind of minimize those impacts. So I don't have a problem.
We can make any approval if it's forthcoming, contingent on a new plan with those items.
Mm-hmm.
A new stormwater maintenance plan.
Yep. Have you gone through this and you know what all the concerns you have are? And, you know, and you're ready to work those out, or are you at the beginning
gone through
of
this? I haven't wrote them down, but it's still my original comments still stands, which is I just thought it was kind of loose. I wanted to tighten it up.
More nailed down. Exactly what
when we did e-cars, we required for the first couple of years rigid maintenance that had to be, you know, proved, written down, reports given to the commission, verification, all that. I don't even know if it needs all that, but maybe for the first year it may.
I suggest we cover those points in the order of addition rather than redirecting the maintenance plan.
You want me, I could just do that, yeah.
Yeah, I think that'd be simple.
They seem
be a faster vehicle.
It could be just added right into the.
No, that would be easy.
Provide a report to the Conservation Commission, you know, stuff like that can be added right into this.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is there, I guess, to come up some sort of approval, like, in the springtime, you need to do this, you know, that type of thing to send off instead of this handwritten, something like that.
You mean like a form?
Come up some sort of form. If we're going to do this every year, something like that.
I can put
that.
A form in the order of conditions that you can just copy and use.
Exactly.
Every year.
Yeah.
Okay.
That we have a checklist. I know in the springtime this is what it is. Then turn it in at this time, and you know.
Yep.
Yeah, that'll be good.
Yep.
Because if you leave me with my own accord, I'll come up with something, you know. Horrible.
It'll come in on the back of a pizza
box.
Box.
Right. I'll deliver it up to you.
It's okay.
As long as it has a meat lover and pizza on the inside.
Sorry,
I'll
make sure.
Here's your report.
I think at that point the word would get out that conservation's getting real loose with their type of submittals.
Yeah.
And you know, so, but I think forms are a great way to standardize things and make it pretty clear exactly what we're looking for and what you need to provide.
Right, that way I fit all the criteria, you know, whatever you want done, so.
Yeah, and we have enough around, there's some that work and some that get really complicated. I'll send you one that's pretty bare bones.
Okay, so is that amenable? All right, any other?
I move we issue order of conditions approving the plans dated July 1st, 2015, or that we received.
June 30th.
It's June 30th.
June 30th, 2015, and with the additional maintenance plan specifications as discussed.
I'll second that. All those in favor?
Should we close the hearing, Chuck?
Yeah.
I move we close the hearing.
Second.
All those in favor? All right.
What's that?
It's done.
Oh, thank you.
Until our next meeting when we sign it and finish the draft of the order of conditions.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Have a good night.
You too. Okay. What changing is that?
This is what they're going to use on West Street.
What's this?
Is that Newport Construction?
No, it's not Newport. I don't have the guy's card, but it's the town contractor for
West
Street. Yeah.
So
I just got one of those in a submittal. That's why I asked.
So what is this?
What is it?
It's called the
Eliminator.
Eliminator. Yeah. I just wondered if someone has any review on the Eliminator.
A storm scepter? Is that what it is?
No.
It's
a hood.
Deep hood. Deep something.
I would.
A hood for construction or permanent?
I know Massey T doesn't use it.
Yeah.
And I think it's a good reason. This is, I believe it's HDP or.
Oh yeah?
It's HDP. If they use the clamshell on there, it's just gone. Sealed. First time they clean it, gone.
Oh, so this is permanent?
Yeah, well, I mean, I assume you can remove it and then no one's going to go down there.
But it's not just for construction.
No, this is for permanent installation in the manhole.
It goes inside the manhole? Because all the manholes are already stockpiled. Like,
I saw that.
Well, it's a hood, yeah. I mean, it's a hood. It
Hold on a second.
I
think it's like an internal sleeve.
You got the wrong address. Ah. So.
And you're saying it won't withstand the clamshell?
Probably not. I mean,
no. Why don't they use that pump truck more? You seem like they're with clamshell, and then we have that nice pump truck.
Don't know.
I can't remember who I was talking to, but one of the guys said it's not the same. There's benefits to using the clamshell for certain things.
Yeah.
Okay, I want to pull us back to the agenda if possible. Chuck, do you want to? Are we talking about West Street now? Is that what?
I just jumped in with that because I thought there was a few minutes between all the new business and wanted to get everyone thinking about.
Okay.
This is something new to me. I haven't seen those before. I was wondering if anyone else had.
So I guess I'll echo what Jamie was saying, which was so you drive down West Street and it's all gravel and the drains are up on the side of the road. Is that typical in road construction?
Yeah.
So what happened to the drains? Did they get backfilled? Or are they just destroyed? That's it. They're just pulled out of the ground until the new ones are put in.
You mean the catch basins?
The piping.
The piping, the catch basins.
Do they cap the piping before they take out the grates?
No,
do you know what I mean?
It's usually remove or replace.
Right.
Or if they have a permit. They silt sack the ones that are there.
Yeah, I don't think.
But they usually high and dry. They usually up in the air. So.
Yeah. I mean, we went through a lot on that permit. I think it's all specified.
Okay. I was just.
But
I gave you the wrong address where those are being used. I'm not sure what's being used on West Street. This is on High Street, and if one is needed, on Howard. So this is the DPW's project on Howard Street where they're going to do that line. But I need the commission to just make a statement where you don't like those and recommend something else, or say find something else and you'll review that also.
Has George looked at it?
George says everyone's using those in town. And so they, I said, well, can I get a copy of that and put it in front of the commission?
Well, if everyone's using it in town, can we go out and see it?
Well, I thought you just said it broke every.
No, I'm not saying that, but I'm saying that it's likely it would break if it was hit.
With that clamshell?
It can break the cast iron.
Mm-hmm.
The cast iron.
Yeah.
So,
And that
I guess I question the need for one of these. I question the effectiveness of these altogether. So to have it in there might not even be necessary. West Street probably doesn't have any because it's a Mass DOT job.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Does that help?
I mean, if they want to use it, I don't know.
No, we didn't answer the question. I have no experience.
Do you have one that you like to see? Is there a few, that MACC and DP is not recommending anyone, any of these things?
Do these things have hoods and something to separate the oil and grease?
This one does, but it's not cast iron.
No.
It's
PVC. No, this one's
PVC,
yeah.
HDP.
So is it usually cast iron?
The old ones are, and they have a hinge on them so they can hinge it up like this to get in between the pipe. I guess this one probably the front face comes off.
So George thinks that every single storm drain is vacuumed out at least within a year and a half in town, if not a year. So
I've heard him say that,
yeah.
And I can't say for sure he's correct, but I don't think he's real far off.
Yeah.
And all the ones in front of my house are done yearly.
Yeah, Wilburn Street are pretty much every year.
I know.
Well, I could put your concerns on
but,
it.
You know, doesn't engineering defer to like standards, like DOT standards or construction standards?
Not necessarily.
Yeah, I would say
but
it was
should
the
we
more
say
norm,
they have
not
to
necessarily, because when it came up in the meeting, the contractor suggested this, and George said everyone's using it. This is the extent of that, and I asked him to let's go over this a little bit, and I was given, this spec sheet.
I guess the only question is it going to be durable enough to stand the test of time and be worth?
Along the
Never,
same line.
Doesn't sound like it.
Doesn't sound like it.
But those things are replaceable.
Have
I did read that
yeah,
on the website, so that's probably why they're not hinged.
While we're on the topic, when you're discussing this, if you could find out how the decision is made to use clamshell versus the vacuum truck.
Because if they have something that's less durable, then they have to back.
Yeah, that might prevent use of the vacuum truck. I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, I wonder if
I,
that's...
I mean, I'd, for every...
To send that to... Send a copy of this to us?
Sure.
Every time I've seen the vac truck used at a catch basin, I've probably seen 10 or 15 clamshells.
Yeah.
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 Is it maybe it's a matter of training with... staff or
availability. I don't know what it is. If you could just find out, because I think in general, like here, Brian might not agree, but in general, the back truck, I think that they're done.
I would think of it too, but there was a reason why that this guy was telling me that he preferred the clamshell.
Okay.
Was he a DPW guy?
I'd say it's probably just easier.
It could be.
He sit there and smoke a cigarette
that
while the clamshell's going up and down. With the backdrop, you have to do something.
You gotta go on.
Well, that's
so
it. It might be training
and
use.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I want to get, we have people here, so I want to get to what order of business do you have with us tonight?
Hi. Good evening.
Good evening.
Conservation Committee.
Just introduce yourself.
My name is Paul Catalano. I'm the contractor for Richard Marino, and that's Richard and his dad, Dennis.
Okay.
And tonight we have a project proposed at 114 Havel Street, and we have a plot plan here to show you. Chuck, before you went on vacation, we had a little bit of paperwork. Do you still have that, or?
I didn't bring it.
Okay. All right. So
I don't mix Chuck. Yep. I don't see it on the agenda.
No.
Or was it just?
Well, it's minor project. It's 114.
Yeah, it's a minor project.
Havel Deck and Breakfast Nook.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
No.
Well, let me. I have a. I do
I
have some plot plans here.
Do you have copies for?
Well, yes, but I would need them back if you don't mind.
Sure.
Make the copies, get them for you.
No, we love to give them back.
Right, thank you so much.
We'll just,
I only use one, I guess, so, you know, I'm gonna pull this one right off my plan.
So are you just,
So before Chuck had left for vacation, he had sat down.
Let's do that.
And we had drawn a barrier, a straw wattle.
Yep.
Basically, we're gonna be roofing and siding this structure. We're gonna be moving a concrete patio that's here, putting a wooden deck, we're gonna be.
Where's the patio?
Okay, so if the patio is right here, so right now it exists at that line.
It's like a flagstone or a slate?
Oh, it's concrete.
Concrete.
So what we're gonna do is remove that, and then this is gonna be a deck that comes out, this is what's gonna wind up being a wall that comes across. This garage walls are taken down, there's a new garage here with a, I have a copy of the plan if you need it. But this structure goes in at 24 by 36, we square off the front, but the real issues here, I guess, are where we're gonna be roofing and siding this main structure. So we drew it a silt fence on some plans that I had given Chuck right here, and kinda kept the work of construction right here. I can draw it on these plans if you like, it'll just take me a second.
Is that silt fence set up, or you're just proposing to put the silt fence? Is it out there now, or?
No, because, you know, trying to.
You haven't started the work.
This is the resource.
Appreciate it.
Yep.
So that's the way to do it.
So let me, I do have some extra, can I show you guys some building plans, so you can kinda see what's going on?
But you're 40 feet from the resource area, right? Is that right?
This is the existing house that's 40 feet from the resource area.
Right.
We are gonna be roofing and siding the structure, so we are gonna take our silt fence and run it from here, all the way around here, and then this way. And right here, our proposed construction, the furthest, closest it'll come is 52.8 feet from the resource area.
Is that the, that's from, that's from the.
This is a 100-foot line, this is a 50-foot line, this is your property line.
So we're, no.
Well.
So.
So your 52 feet is from the property line, not necessarily to the wetland?
No, it's not, that's the margin of error for the wetlands.
Oh.
You got 52.
Yeah, 60 or 70 feet from the wetland, the structure.
No, that's 52, it's just the.
And this is, you said roofing and siding, you're taking down the old side?
Taking off the old side, taking off the roofing, you know, cart it in the dumpster on the other side of the property, put it in there.
Right, and that's 40 feet from the resource area.
Right. In addition to that, we're also, let me have some plans I can show you.
Minor, we issued a minor province.
Like what, how does it get filed?
And seemed like.
The big question is, how does it get filed?
Well, it's already a minor province, it's already been issued.
Okay. Okay, gotcha. It's just an awful lot of work.
Things a little.
Happening within 100 feet.
See if I can, thank you. I don't know if I have that many copies, but these are my plans I was gonna submit to the building department, but they're good enough for the conservation. So, I might have to ask you guys to share plans.
Yeah, that's fine, we could do that.
Could I ask you guys to share plans?
Yeah, fine.
Do you have one?
Absolutely, we're close friends.
Okay, so if you open up, the front page, you'll see that we're gonna infill this front section here, of this 10-foot section, where's the front, right here.
That here is here.
And then we're gonna put this.
Here's the garage.
Yeah, we're gonna put this 24 by 36 structure on, which is here and here. And if you open up, the next page, you'll see how the floor plans lay out.
You're not expanding the basement?
Not expanding the basement. Now, back here is that deck, that's 52.8 feet, right there. So you get a good, when you look at this floor plan, this corner right here, is that, you have a, is that 52.8 foot right there, so. Not this corner, but this corner right here is the 52.8 feet from the wetland.
Yeah.
So basically, you can, basically, the plan will tell you the rest of the story, but I'd be more than glad to narrate it.
At this point, I mean, I get a pretty good sense of the project. Are there any questions about the project?
No major concrete work here, just here, in from that corner, because this comes out another 3 or 4 feet to make that 52, so we'll be working this way away. So when you look at the foundation plan, let me skip you up a little bit. When you look at the foundation plan. Is it the last page? We don't have a foundation plan, do we?
No,
this has the detail.
Well, I had a foundation drawing here.
Yeah,
maybe some of these are just my here's a foundation plan here. So this the deck comes a couple of feet past this, so we'll be digging this way, away from the wetland. So we're gonna put this wall in. These walls exist. We're adding to them here. So we're really not digging everything up. We're just gonna be, anything that we dig, we're gonna pull away from the wetland and stack away behind the silt fence that we're gonna have laid out. And like I said, I can just draw that right on there if you allow me.
Just a little background. So there's already a minor project for this?
I think, yes. This gentleman came in and told me about his project, and I said it fit the minor project criteria.
Mm-hmm.
I signed off on it, and you
yes,
put
sir.
In the application, and he's just, I believe he's just here to explain it.
Is this any different than what he originally explained to you?
No, this is exactly the same. I don't think any changes. I even recognize the plan, so it's
okay.
Very similar.
I'm fine with my
I'm fine with this. I mean, the closest to the resource area is over 40 feet, and that's just new siding. And a new construction or groundbreaking is
over
at least 70 feet
yeah.
from
yeah.
the
yeah.
Resource area.
Yep.
If he's going to put in a steel fence, I'm good.
Yep.
I
agree.
If it's okay with the committee, I can coordinate the location of the fence with Dr. Petroni and
sure.
come in and give you a plot plan with that.
Sure, we can locate it on site.
You want
to?
Okay.
Are you ready to submit your building application?
Yes, I was just hoping to get an okay from you from this committee.
Yep, please do. I will work off the building application. We have the ability to write on that and have some
right.
notes on it, and
okay.
I can do that. So you don't have to, I'll just.
If you need more time.
No. I don't want you to lose that sheet.
The next thing you hear from us will be just. Some notes on your building application.
Some conditions, where to place the fence.
Just, I'll ask you to call me and when the erosion control is put in. And if you're unsure of that, call me and we'll figure out where that is. I'll go out on the site with you.
Would you prefer the straw wattle?
Straw wattle will be fine.
Straw wattle will
yeah.
be fine. 12 inch straw wattle will be fine.
Yep. Is that roll that you buy?
Yes.
Yeah, that
so
one's fine for this project.
Put a stake in it here and there?
Yeah. It'd be good.
Just for perspective, in my opinion, this is the type of project that would have a minor permit for. I mean, even though we're building some new structures, the existing structures between the resource area and the new structure, he's not breaking any new ground between the existing structure and the resource area. He's 50 feet back or more. I think this is exactly the type of thing for a minor project, in my opinion. Even though we're building a fair number of new square feet, it's the resource area is not affected.
Right.
Yeah.
And I don't know if there's any confusion on this. It was never anything but a minor project.
Right.
Yeah. This was definitely. I mean, I think that when I first saw your, I might have confused you a little bit because when I saw the plans, didn't understand where you were building and where you weren't. But then you explained, how minuscule and what certain areas you were just filling in. So. Works out.
Thank you. Yes.
So submit that building application and we can start rolling forward.
So,
okay.
So when I submit it, they'll obviously communicate with you and you'll say, okay, we're going to okay this one.
Yes.
Some paperwork,
that's
or
right.
line of communication. Or
the only thing you have to think of right now is just the building department.
Okay.
They will notify me. You don't have to come back to the but there will be a note on your building permit.
Thank you very much.
That's the old
one. Taking the time with us, we appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Go ahead,
Brian. Okay, I do it, Jamie. This project is a perfect example of the volume of work not dictating whether it's a minor project or not. There's a fair amount of work happening on the structure. However, the nature of the work makes it.
And the distance
makes it such that it is a minor project.
Yeah, yeah. Otherwise, if we didn't have the minor project vehicle for your project, I don't know if you were notified, but it would definitely be a request for determination of applicability with a different set of fees and a different
time frame
and filing requirement. Go ahead, Chuck.
Can I sneak? I have a bunch of stuff to bring up to the commission. I'm just going to sneak them in as we have a minute.
Let's do it.
This is 88 Timberneck. and I was wondering if the commission was concerned or needed to make a policy about converting existing sheds that are quite close to the resource area, within 25 feet, into animal anythings. In this case, it's going to be a chicken coop, but there's been horses.
Thank you, folks.
Thank you, have a good night.
And things like that. So I didn't know if there was a policy that would prevent anyone from putting a chicken coop within the 25-foot or the 35-foot, other than our standard structural. This is a conversion of an existing shed into a chicken coop, but they need a run.
Well,
you guys know what I'm talking about.
I've got a question. What are existing conditions around that shed? Is it one of these sheds that's in the wetlands?
It's pretty close. This is Timonex Swamp. I mean,
yeah.
That's
no,
right.
I get it.
Yeah, I'll switch this. So it's close, and you know, I don't know what any concerns are. I mean, it shows it a little bit further away, but it's not. It's right there.
When you say convert existing shed, are they tearing down the existing?
No, I mean it's reuse prior to this change was a shed for lawnmower, whatnot. Now it's going to be a chicken.
But the same structure.
Yes. Same structure.
Same foundation.
Yeah.
I think in general, if it's just a change in use.
Well, it's not the structure. It's the chickens. It's the chicken debris.
It's the iguana.
That's what I'm asking. Do you guys have any issues with animals close to the wetlands?
I do not. I think that's fine.
I think the volume of poultry that you need to do any sort of change to that wetland would be like.
Would it overtake the house?
Are you worried about disturbance or anything like that? Like if he ran that in,
well, let me just
change it back.
I
if he runs it into the direction of the wetland, would that bother anyone? It doesn't really matter.
My
what
understanding.
Do you mean by runs it into the?
Hold on a second. Let me get this straight.
Like do a little run out into the wetlands for the chickens to.
The run is just a wooden elevated ramp, right?
Right.
Chuck.
What's that?
The run is
a
wooden elevated ramp.
This will be on the ground, just with chicken wires around it. And his original plan was to build something rustic, but build it. And then I asked him to really let me talk to you guys first.
I just want to say two things. First of all, I think the Board of Health, the Health Department, is going to put more restrictions on this than we would typically. Because I know somebody in town who's gotten a chicken coop and all of the notifications and requirements that were required for her to put it in her backyard. That said, I don't want to see additional build out between the back of that shed and the wetlands.
Even if it's like sticks and chicken wire, like pretty rustic. You know, you don't need much.
Well, I do want to say that protecting the chickens from what's outside is more going to take more than sticks and chickens.
So we're kind of getting down to two things. Animal seems to be okay close.
Right.
What is the definition of a structure? How, you know, what constitutes a structure? Is it just a couple of boards? Or does it mean, you know, something built, something, the fasteners and whatnot?
I would say, in my opinion, if there's disruption of the ground for any kind of foundation, that's a structure. Now, beyond that, I think it almost has to be on a case-by-case basis.
So if he just pounded in some posts, you're good?
I'm good.
Metal picket posts.
I'm good with that.
Okay.
That really won't disrupt the root zone too substantially.
No. If anything, it'll aerate the soil.
Right.
I think that makes sense.
Okay.
Did you read that article about the chickens?
Which one?
Globe?
No.
No, I didn't.
You want to give us 2 seconds?
Yeah, it's a salmonella outbreak, and they recommend that people not kiss their chickens.
Oh.
But there's a picture of this woman,
you
know, smooching her chicken.
Okay.
Yeah, really.
Well, it's all types. Okay.
That must have been on
the real story was
the
chicken got the salmonella from the woman.
So what's next?
That's good advice.
Yeah,
it is.
Jeez. this one's a little more difficult, and so I'm gonna hold off on that one. So we're, I gotta set it up. I thought you would do something in between. The town wants to.
The who?
The town.
The town is going to accept some streets at the next town meeting. And we're in the process of, private streets, and we're in the process of kind of figuring out what's needed. So there's a Carriage Lane Estates 1 and 2. So.
Where is that? Oh, down, I know that is down.
Where is that?
Where is it?
It's Gregory.
That's the one with the retaining walls on his side going across the wetland, right?
Yeah.
Oh, it's in Woburn?
Pretty close, yeah. Well, the road to get to it's in Reading.
So Carriage Lane,
yeah, but the
Estates 2 is.
Right.
Right, I think so, yeah.
Well, let's find out.
Gregory, Zachary, and Corey. And so it's going to be multiple roads all around. But what our issue is, they want to accept the roads. I found out that there's a lot of houses and a lot of projects that still don't have a certificate of compliance.
Oh.
And I'm wondering how the commission wants to do this. Do
because
we say go ahead with, because there's no road related issues with our order? The wetlands are in back of the house. There wasn't anything in the order of conditions that needed something in the road. Or are we gonna make a stand and say this subdivision hasn't received a final order of conditions on all the properties? So
order of conditions or
certificate of compliance on all the properties, so we're not gonna give our approval.
Well, let me back you up there for a second. What's different from back then to now is a order of conditions was issued for a subdivision and not for an individual lot. I guess we would do the same thing now if it was a subdivision. So a certificate of compliance, so the overall certificate of compliance is not issued until every lot is clear. So that's the issue that you're talking about, right?
Well, every lot you can do partials, and then when
right.
the last 10 are completed, they can come in for those last 10 all at once
right.
for the final order or the final certificate.
But what you're saying is not all of the lots have technically been completed, even if they were constructed in the
right.
80s.
Right.
Right.
And most of these are, we're talking 90s, late 80s.
Yeah.
But isn't the onus on those lot current lot owners when they sell to
Well, that's
that?
The difficulty, you know? It's
right.
it's an overall certificate of compliance for the whole subdivision.
For this whole
it's
subdivision,
the,
gotcha.
The problem is if that subdivision, say the drainage system, the pavement, the sidewalks, are in compliance with the order of conditions, if the town takes them over, then the town is buying that problem.
Yeah.
And the developer is off the hook.
Right.
I don't think the town should accept those streets until they have a certificate of compliance.
But okay, so what I did was I read each order of conditions. There was no, and a lot of these do not have any road related issues.
So there's no, nothing.
So so one of my questions, if that's the case, can we sign off on the road being accepted, or do you still want a certificate of compliance for the subdivision, which is going to be hard to get because a lot of these people aren't around anymore?
Maybe I'm thinking the wrong thing, but what I'm thinking of is the road goes through the wetland, and there's a big retaining wall.
But so if the road has...
So, there's one, which one? Roma Lane, you're right.
Yeah.
Roma Lane is one that there's a road through a wetland.
Right.
But it was already issued. So we did all this research, and it was one, like you just said, there's something through the wetland. It didn't get a final certificate of compliance, but that's off the list now because it was accepted.
So
accepted by the town.
By the town, yeah. So the only confusion with that is it may not have been ratified or something, so it might have to go back through. But Roma Lane was on the list and it was taken off. But we gave a order of certificate of compliance for a lot and the roadway on that. So that wouldn't be an issue for us.
Okay, what about the others?
It's just down to this Carriage Lane 2, which is all the wetlands are in back, and I can't find any road-related issues on the order of conditions. And if there are, I'll bring them to you, but usually it's not like that. It's not what we're talking about. Some of the lots that have the detention ponds have received a partial order of conditions, and that, so that's all that.
Someone explain to me, so partial, you know,
it's for that, for everything on that lot. It's like a certificate of compliance.
So a partial of a roadway would essentially be no different than, you know, if we're the town is.
Right, so the one I said that had the roadway involved, it's for the entire roadway. You can't partially accept a roadway.
Right.
Can't
no,
partially
you're saying,
accept
you're
one
saying
lot.
It's the roadway portion of an order.
I'm not suggesting we issue a certificate of compliance. I'm just saying we give our okay for the roadway,
right, right.
And we wait, like we have been, for the certificates of compliance to come in when they refinance, or I could write some letters, but it shouldn't slow down this process.
I have a question, Chuck. The roadways, how do they comply with stormwater regs? I mean, isn't that under our purview as well? And have they met everything that was supposed to be put in for, like, you know, drainage and rate of runoff and that type of thing?
Well, you know, again, we're not, that's a great question, but we're not going to rewrite the orders of conditions. So when I review the order of conditions and it doesn't ask for anything,
mm-hmm.
then it's
mm-hmm.
not our problem.
Oh, it didn't ask for anything.
Right, so each one has been reviewed.
That's today's.
And I'm only
that was
bringing
so old.
To you the road-related,
the
road-related ones. They're really...
Okay, I'll buy that.
So, and also, you know, I agree with what Jamie was saying, that the town shouldn't take on almost accept the responsibility that somebody else should have followed through on in terms of gaining compliance.
I'm wondering if the town should acquire a road that doesn't meet today's stormwater standards.
Well, another part of this
you can't
is...
go back,
well, the
though.
Engineering
well, another part of this
is reviewing this also.
I mean, another part of this is by the time we do, if the town were to accept to take the road, you know, even if that original order of conditions was valid at the time, it's outdated now. You know, and what's the condition of the road now? Well, it's deteriorated since the, you know, it's just the longer it goes, the bigger the can of worms, kind of. The road breaks down, it has to be fixed. Who replaced that? Did anybody tell? Is that still in compliance with the order of conditions? I mean, it can just become a big mess. What was the carriage road issue? You said it crossed a wetland.
No, that was Roma Lane. And
I
don't think that's an issue because we got a road-related partial certificate of compliance.
So carriage road does not cross a wetland.
I'm thinking of something else.
So what, there was an issue?
It looks like the wetlands, you know, the carriage road, which is George, Zachary, and Corey, seem to have wetlands in the back of the houses.
Right.
Okay.
So there was no stream crossing or anything like that. So I, you know, I'm thinking that we could just bless the road and wait for the orders, wait for the certificate of compliance when needed, or I could send letters requesting them, but, you know, we don't have to link the two things together. So the list was Hanscom, F Street, which was is
Hanscom?
Where's Hanscom? I know where.
That's next to where I live. How's that not accepted?
I don't know. It's on here.
Really?
F Street, which has no issues. I checked the two houses on either side. There's nothing
F
open.
F Street is down there across from REI.
Yeah.
All wetland down there.
It is, but it wasn't a subdivision. It was just a private street. So the commission never gave doesn't have an order of condition on a subdivision. And they don't have any open orders of conditions on any house on that street.
Okay.
So we're okay with that.
Yeah.
Timothy Place, we found a certificate of compliance. Sailor Tom's Way, you just reviewed it, there was no issues. Pondview Lane, that.
Where is that?
Pond.
That's about Zachary, isn't it?
I thought that was off. Franklin.
Here we go.
No.
I'm gonna test my geography.
There's no wetlands there.
Doesn't Pondview Lane B be renamed Wet Meadow Drive.
Yeah, right.
There it is right here.
Whoa.
Does anyone recognize this area?
You're moving too fast.
This is a little weird about this thing, but yeah, it's touchy.
Yeah, it's over there, it's that Zachary Lane area.
Ashley Place.
I don't see a pond. Oh, Fireman Ice Pond.
They filled it in, it was right there at the end of the cul-de-sac.
Yes, obviously the ice pond that Bill used to talk about all the time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nugent does seem to have a request, and I asked the engineering department to go out there where there was supposed to be some rerouting of a drain, storm drain that went on a driveway and was connected to basin and then out to the wetland. They're gonna check on that for us. And I'll have to come back to you with whatever they have. Bethune Ave, Al Couliad's.
Yeah. We know that's built to standard.
And then Devidence.
Well, what was the one before Devidence?
Bethune,
which was.
Have we issued a certificate of compliance?
Yeah. I'm just giving you the list.
Just the list,
it's
all the time.
Again, it's only Carriage Lane, it's, I only need direction on Gregory, Zachary, and Corey, and to say that there's a lot of open orders out there, none of them seem to be road-related issues inside the order of conditions. Can we give a blessing on the road if that's the case, or do I need to start writing letters and get everyone into compliance because this particular one, the developer is, something happened to him.
If there's no road-related stipulation in the existing uncompleted order of conditions, then I don't have an issue.
I don't either.
I'm still struggling with the town accepting a street that meet current stormwater standards.
That would be under.
I'd love to see
we have authority under Clean Water Act and Stormwater to make sure that things comply with
Stormwater
regs.
Have a bond on them still, so if something's needed, you know, there's money.
Think about this. If the town was proposing to build that road rather than take over one that's already there, we would require them to meet current stormwater standards.
Yeah, but it's, isn't it?
I mean,
what is it, doubled indemnity? You can't go back and,
I mean,
acquire.
What if bond money was used to go back and inspect the drainage structures? Just as a final inspection.
The developer was, being here with his lawyer.
I don't think you can do that.
You know, I agree with that too. You can't go back and rewrite. I mean, that's been in a lot of MACC articles. They say you can't, even though it sounds like a good idea, you can't require something that's not in the order of conditions.
Yeah, you're thinking the right thing, but I just don't think you can do it. Just for the sake of.
I think the possibility of getting something that's deficient corrected is better.
From the town.
If it's in the town.
It's easier. Sometimes it's not easy, but it's easier.
Think about this for a minute. Suppose that street didn't meet current town engineering specifications. The concrete wasn't thick enough, or the crown wasn't steep enough. I don't think the town would take that.
Well, that's it.
Wouldn't take it over.
That's it.
So why should we be less demanding than engineering? If they're not going to take over a street that doesn't meet their specs, why should we take over a street that doesn't meet our specs?
We're not taking it over.
Because we don't have clear written specs to start with. What he's saying is there's no road related issues in the existing uncompleted orders of conditions. So there's nothing, I mean there's no road issues that we mention in those orders of conditions. So we don't have the order of conditions to go back to say you didn't meet this criteria for this road, complete that, and then sell it, you know, and then take it to the town.
They said Devidence Road is so old, you know, there's nothing on it. So if you guys don't know anything, it's nothing in the conservation files.
Hmm.
I mean,
well, I will ask George at town meeting.
Yeah.
if this meets current stormwater standards.
I think it's a great.
Roma Lane, no road-related issues. Pondview, partial certificate of compliance was given to the right-of-way. Hanscom Road, certificate of compliance was issued for the subdivision. Bethune Ave, there's one dead tree. I already called Al about that, because that was part of the ones we asked for.
Yeah.
So he's, you know.
He's replacing.
Different man these days. He's gonna replace that tree.
Okay, great.
Sailor Tom Way, we talked about that. Nugent Timothy's Place, commission voted on Timothy's Place that they require a 4-foot sump and 2 catch basins. Engineering's gonna check that for me, and they would like in the files it says, look, we'll give you a certificate of compliance if these two things happen. One, you know, a 4-foot sump, 2 catch basins, so that's big money. But an as-built plan. They wanted an as-built plan for that lot, so that's Timothy's Place.
That's on the lot or on the development?
That's on the development, so that's Timothy's Place.
Do we know if the catch basin's in there?
The engineering's checking that for me. So they're gonna go out and check that to see if someone put a 4-foot sump in the 2 catch basins that are out there. So that could be up in the air. That's a road-related issue.
Which one is that?
Timothy's Place.
Timothy's Place.
And that's formerly 379 Haverhill Street, and we have DP file number on it, and it's not closed up. And the other one's Nugent, and that's, it's like a confusing little map here. It's the catch basin and the drain manhole discharge in the direction of the basin on lot number 1, pre-existing pipe under the driveway, blah, 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 needed to be rerouted into the manhole and then into the detention pond, and this wasn't done, or this was done, and this was what was asked for in the order of conditions. So I have to verify that that was done, and then that one would be fine, but still there's no certificate of compliance, and there's no, well, actually, the Nugents are still living there from what I hear, so this could be attainable. And then an as-built plan was asked for also. So that's,
all right.
We have 2 out of 10. That's an issue now.
Timothy's Way and Nugent.
And Nugent seem to be the two that we have road-related issues to. Carriage Lane 2, we also don't have certificates of compliance for, but we don't have any road-related issues.
Okay, when's the next town meeting?
In the fall.
Oh, okay. Okay. Any other comments about?
No, I heard you say if it's not a road-related issue, you're good with accepting the road or giving a blessing on the road, and then we have to look into those other two.
Right.
And I'll come back to you with that information.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, what's next? Minor, should we go to the minor projects? Or you said you had a number of things.
Well, yeah, I do. I do have another one. I only have one plan. This came in, and I'm just gonna talk about it for a second. So here's a plan from Sullivan Engineering. It shows an addition that encroaches into the 35-foot and the 25-foot area.
Proposed?
Location?
Proposed, yeah.
An address?
On sonotubes. This is what I'm getting. This is all I got.
Yep.
But I asked the applicant what's happening, not Jack, the applicant, and he said this is all going to be on sonotubes. But again, it's encroaching into the 35-foot structure zone. It's coming in as an RDA. So here, take a look at that. But last week, under Jack Sullivan, we accepted 87, our last meeting, we accepted 87 Avalon without a variance, very similar. The commission's comment was it was an existing deck within the 25-foot buffer. They pulled it out of there and built a new deck, still within the 25-foot buffer, but a little bit back. So the commission said, for that reason, we're not going to ask for a variance, and it's acceptable under this RDA. And then we have the sports court on 258 Lowell Street. So I'm, and we all know that that's close and it's a structure and blah, blah, blah.
no variance RDA. I need some direction on this type of stuff. Maybe we add it to what's acceptable in an RDA, or are we getting worried about that 35-foot line, or will, every project is always at the 35-foot line these days.
What's this, what's the, is this something here now, or is that just a sunroom proposed in the 35-foot?
Yeah, those two, does that say
so
proposed?
There was nothing there currently?
I don't think there's anything.
There's nothing here?
There's nothing there currently, there in 35-foot, there's no way it's an RDA.
No way. No way, and don't even file a notice of intent for that.
So how was it?
Putting a foundation in the 35-foot zone?
Sonotubes.
Well, no, it's on sonotubes.
It's a foundation.
It is.
Sonotubes.
Unless it's cantilever, that's a foundation.
Yeah. No, I agree. So Avalon, I don't think I was here for that hearing, but it looks like their deck within 35 feet was a smaller size deck, and there was a pre-existing that went into the 25.
Right.
Yeah, it was.
So it was a pullback.
Right.
And you know, in terms of
that would have been
absolute
to,
situations.
You know, I would have said no intent, but
yeah,
but
it, that's one of those for me I would have said right on the line.
It's hard to be on, I mean I feel it.
It's hard to be
on the spot when I don't know the answer.
When you don't know the answer, say file an RDA.
Really?
Absolutely.
Why not be stronger on if you don't know the answer?
What?
Yeah.
It'd be stronger.
Why?
Well, I mean,
like
if you, know, if you know the answer, that's great. But if you do not know the answer, then have them file an RDA and let the commission take the heat.
Oh, I hear what you're saying. Well, that's what it's there for, right?
Yeah, one thing we were supposed to do, and we've been remiss as can be, is develop a policy that listed what's a minor project and what isn't.
Almost.
What about a policy that would say if you are, you know, working within 40 feet of the wetland, it's a notice of intent.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
Or something like that. You can word it any way you want, but that gives me a line and tells me, look, if you're closer than 40 feet. There's no possibility this would ever be an RDA, so you just let's just get going on the.
Well, I would. I mean, I don't want to get that into the weeds, so to speak, or to the BBW, but if they're within 40 feet, but they're not disturbing the ground, an RDA might be okay. It's if you're disturbing. I agree with you. If you're disturbing the ground with a foundation or grading or sonotubes within 40 feet, then 99 times out of 100 is going to be an NOI.
But it wasn't for Avalon.
So Avalon, well, that was one where we let it come in.
We let it come in as an RDA.
Avalon was like you said, Jamie, I didn't say it before this, but this came to the commission, and the commission says it's fine.
It was an RDA, though, right?
It was an RDA.
Right, it was an RDA.
So you can't have it, and you can't be going... If I wait for you guys to say it and you say it's a notice of intent, then that's why I told you it was the same firm, Sullivan Engineering, because now everything that is this close, he's going to stop
sending
us.
No, but this is a better
RDA.
Condition.
Yeah. Was that new? Was
that yeah, that was just in the last year or two.
Well, no, I mean, this was last...
You know, I think the thing...
2 weeks?
Yeah, it wasn't long ago.
Yeah.
I know. It was 2 weeks, but it wasn't long ago.
I think what Chuck's highlighting here is, you know, are we going to set up an absolute kind of trigger rule?
You don't want to give, you know, different information to the public.
Right.
And that's why the line in the sand would be great. And I understand that you're saying, well, we're not talking about a deck, and we're not talking about a shed, and we're not talking about a garden. But if it was an addition in the 40-foot line, maybe that's always... a notice of intent. I mean, I don't know how you guys want to do this, but
I think one of the biggest challenges to that is most people near wetlands in Redding are within 40 feet. I mean, all these lots are small, and if people are going to do anything in their backyard, they're within 40 feet, and they have wetlands near them. You know, they are within 40 feet. So,
well, to keep in mind, the purpose is of RDA. Request for determination, and it's by the wetlands laws and our bylaws, it's up to the commission to make that determination. I mean, they could file an RDA and then we could
say negative or positive.
Exactly.
That's what we're supposed to do. So, I mean, like I said, if you're not sure, tell them about an RDA, and then we can approve it or require an NOI.
But I think what Chuck's emphasizing is he wants to give the applicant some sort of guidance up front and understanding before.
I don't think we usually get
And so that we.
Definite. But we're getting,
some sort of policy.
That's given me some direction. It hasn't, you know, I think that the commission, and again, going back to the RDA, so look, the first permits was a notice of intent, but then all the towns, just went wild, and they everything had to be a permit, and so the DEP said, look, let's put this other thing in here so you can take a look at it and then determine if it needs to be reviewed by the commission. So that's what we're doing, but I just want to remind the commission that when we do a RDA and something happens, we have no recourse, because determination is that it's not likely to alter the wetland.
Right.
That's no matter if it has conditions on it or not.
But if they file an RDA and we issue a negative determination, and then they go ahead and start building it, and they build something that's different from what they submitted, then we can issue an enforcement action.
Right.
No. Yeah, that's true. That's absolutely true. You could tell me that everything in this town is going to be an RDA from here forward. I'm absolutely happy with it. I just need to know. I don't want to go, hold off, guy, until the next meeting. I'm going to just tell you, let's file this, and past practice has let a few in, but, not everything is the same. So I do have to say that these two, I would have, 258 and 87, I would have said that those were notices of intent.
Due to proximity.
Well, only because
the
sports court was in 25 feet.
You're
it was 15 feet.
You're off the hook, Chuck, because we could have made that determination.
Yeah.
We're the ones on the hook now.
Yeah.
For those. So I mean,
I think everybody would rather have a request for determination. It's just friendlier and easier. It works out fine.
You mean as opposed to NOI?
Right.
Going directly to NOI.
Yeah.
But if you get a positive determination, now you spend more.
Yeah.
Well, true, and you do like to tell them what's going to happen. I mean, I could tell everyone, everyone comes in with a request first, and then we decide at the meeting whether it's a notice of intent or not. But that's a month.
I think there's ones that are clear cut that we know, and I think it's easy enough, but I don't think there's going to be a blanket policy. It's going to be easy enough where you figure out a blanket policy.
Yeah, and Chuck, you also, along those lines, you have the option of saying, this is a close call, I don't know, why don't you give me your plans, I'll put them in the commissioner's package, they'll make a site visit on Monday night or Sunday morning, and then at the next meeting, they can discuss it and lend their opinion, what it should be. That's always an option.
Right. Well, I'm going to use the RDA, but I'm going to go back to kind of where I was before. So when this 25, whatever it was, comes in, and they're new construction within the 35 feet, I'm going to go back to the regulations, which say, first off, you need a variance. And secondly, you don't get a variance unless you file a notice of intent to request that variance. So those are in the regulations. So I kind of felt confident saying that, figuring that you needed a variance to go forward. This is something that needs a variance. 87 needed a variance. 258 needed a variance. And that's really where I was drawing that from, but I was a little bit confused with the results of these things. And then seeing that it was Jack again, I just wanted to make sure that I brought it to you guys, because I'm gonna have a conversation with them and say, look, this is how it's done.
I do want to say personally that in the vast majority of cases, I think you make the right call. I think when you don't know, you come to the commission, and in the vast majority of cases, when you advise an applicant, it usually comes. And sometimes we say, well, why wasn't this an RDA? I mean, you're gonna miss some, but I think your judgment is good. That's my personal opinion.
Appreciate
appreciate that.
And I wasn't worried about, you know, how I felt about it. I just, it's always good to have a conversation with the commission and say, where you at? Do you see it differently? And I kind of get the understanding of how you want it. You know, we really have no nailed anything down, but I think we have tightened it up a little bit. And I would have called this guy back right away and said, this is a notice of intent, but again, I was a little bit confused on these last two.
From Avalon's perspective, I think the perspective of the commission was, if they were going in the same location, that it was being pulled back away from the resource area. So that one seemed very different than what we were just looking at in that case.
And there were no grading changes, that they were gonna replace the existing.
One of my faults is I'm a strict constructionist, and it says it in the regulations. I just go, oh, well, you need a variance. It's only one way to get it, so.
Okay.
That's it for that.
Minor projects? The 205 Pearl Street?
Yeah, 205 Pearl Street was just a fire pit, and what was interesting was that they're allowed in town now.
Right, it has been 75 feet from a structure.
25 feet from a structure. There is a 75 foot in there somewhere. It's not my regulations, but we did work with the fire department. But I bet you the gentleman at 205, he knows those regulations because he was really the first one, and it took a long time to get him. He talked to me well before
July. And he
July.
Said 25 feet?
You have to be 25 feet from the structure.
I thought 75 feet is whatever.
There was a 75 foot in there, something like that. Maybe it's 75 foot from the neighbor's house or something.
I thought you needed a permit
or 75
for have an open fire.
For an open fire, you do. It has to be, the primary intent has to be cooking. So you need to have a marshmallow stick by the fire pit.
I think it's changed altogether. This was a patio and fire pit. That's what he requested, and he got that permit, 25 feet away from his house.
Good luck.
No marshmallow needed. So.
We would know that'd be primarily for cooking.
BYOB,
BYOM. Food.
Bring your own marshmallow.
Anyways, I thought that was interesting, and now we're reviewing on view permit. We're checking off needs to be reviewed by the fire department, which is great, and you know, to tell you, I'm so glad they're allowing fire pits somewhere in Massachusetts. It's crazy that we can't do that. So
it's worse than crazy. You go to any Home Depot patio place, and they're selling them like crazy.
I'm not kidding. Yeah.
Going to the plumbing alley, got a bunch of stuff that's not cool.
Then you're approached by like 3 or 4 guys in the parking lot trying to, you know, get you to sell, buy some too, huh?
Okay, 1364 Westgate.
Come over my van, I want to show you something.
Yeah. Got some fire pits back here.
Got a few extra
approved.
It'd be a boom.
So you know, that's Westgate. They needed some more storage. They needed some storage, and they needed a tree to be taken down. The tree was quite close to the wetlands, but it was completely dead. But I did take the step, which is my usual step when a tree needs to come down, is I have arborist, tree company, verify that it's dead and write some sort of email or something to me saying that. So the tree's coming down, and the storage shed was placed 50 feet away from the wetlands. So I approved
awesome.
It under a minor project
that
permit.
Sounds good.
So this breakfast nook we talked about.
Yep, yes. Okay, certificate of compliance for 39 Lindsay Lane.
Yeah, and you reviewed this well before. Last meeting I was at.
Did we somebody do a site visit?
Yes.
Yes.
Probably made it right.
No, I think I did.
Did you?
Is that the one with the silt fence at ground level?
No.
What?
That was the one with the smell?
No.
Oh, yeah. That was
yeah. All right. There are three of them with snow.
Yeah. That was the one with the snow, yeah.
Yeah.
This is a gentleman that's selling his house, and he needed to comply when they found that the order of conditions didn't have a certificate of compliance. So I don't know what the, you know, these old ones, I mean.
Well, I move we issue a certificate of compliance.
You did move, you did that, we only need a sign.
Yeah, we did.
Only need to sign it.
Oh, we did.
I just need a sign.
All right.
Let's sign it.
Moving on.
Sign this up.
Okay, the next thing is the order of conditions for 629 Pearl.
629 Pearl found his order of conditions. We do not need to sign this.
Very nice.
I wonder why I don't remember it.
We signed it, sent it to him, he didn't pick it up. It was in this like 14-20 day no man's black hole from the postal service. So that's
a package I'm waiting for right
found.
Now that's in a black hole.
Okay.
Between Boston and here, seriously. It's been between Boston and here 12 days. I think they're carrying it by hand.
It was crazy. You can track that thing. It was like all over the state. That's very good. I have to, you know, say.
All right, and I can't believe we're doing this in late July, but let's debrief Friends and Family Day.
You already did.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, we're talking about the
last
turtle
time?
Trying to crawl out of the
Okay. We already did that last meeting.
Yeah.
Okay.
She loves that.
All right. Oh, I dropped off the sign for you. The red X.
I found that stressful too. You know,
yeah,
like
it
always
was.
Trying to climb out. I was gonna put him back in the Ipswich. He probably would have been happier.
I don't think he was from the Ipswich.
No, he wasn't.
He was.
That's where
he was
found.
Pulled out. He was found there.
But
found
he's
the
not
Ipswich.
Native.
No,
no,
he's
a pet.
That's where he's found.
Oh, jeez.
He's
a pet.
He was native for a short while.
Okay. Well, let's get to the officer election.
Do you want to do that last, or do you want to do the emergency permit next?
Oh, no, let's not do that yet.
Let's.
Sorry, I had a bunch of stuff. So there's a pipeline, it's called the Beverly-Salem Lateral.
Right.
Any comments on that? They're doing operation maintenance, I didn't think so.
Is that the one that...
RMLD, sorry.
Is that the one that there were these two figures sent with that?
Yes,
that
yes.
These two
okay.
Yeah.
Massive
all right.
Yeah.
Sheets.
Yeah. RMLD has come up with their own operation and maintenance plan, and you know, I guess they deal with a bunch of towns, and they've got approval by two of the towns, and two of the other towns, Reading being one of them, hasn't approved this yet. I'm going to send this out, and if you feel like it's something you can agree to, they need us to agree to it.
Do they have a general permit right now?
I've seen a general permit for them, and I'm not sure if it allows all the stuff they want to do. So there's been some new regulations. We used to surgically prune around wires with our old people.
Our old.
Well, I can't say their name. Aspinall. What is that? Was that company? That's what they.
Oh yeah.
So and now we're using Meyer, and they want to go for, you know, they want to anticipate 3-year growth and do an 8-foot.
That's actually an industry standard now. As of.
Well, it hasn't been accepted here.
We've already talked about it.
What seems to be the problem with what's happening? We've been going out a little bit back and forth. We've had two meetings already. Is they want to use their professional judgment to cut down trees. And we're getting into trees being cut. They weren't notifying the Conservation Commission. They feel like, in my opinion, they feel like once they're out there, time is of the essence, and they need to take action, and they've been given permission to do certain work, and they're okay with expanding it a little bit. And it hasn't worked out with the tree warden, it hasn't worked out with me. So some of the things they hadn't even been doing is to add the Conservation Commission to the email list. And then they're not telling us about emergencies when they're cutting trees down. They're going out on an emergency and then never coming back and saying, this is what we did. They're taking the opportunity to have an emergency and then clear that street also, which wasn't on the list. And it wasn't supposed to be on the list that month or something like that. So they're just.
Are they asking for a new general permit?
They're not. They're asking to look at this operation maintenance plan and see if we agree with it.
I know we were presented with
the new guidelines for trimming around wires. It talks about the 8-foot buffer, actually, you remember 5 feet for something. We're at, cutting it at the branch collar and not at the wire. And that has been an industry standard they've been going to as sort of a response to this October storm or took down all of 3 years ago. So that's why it's not new to me, but the tree cutting down thing, I don't know why it was presented. I remember when it was presented, Will was on the commission. So it was fairly, it was within the last year that we talked about it. And the response of the commission was, you know, it's easy enough to inspect the work that they're doing, so if there's an issue, we can notify them. That was the result of it wasn't a presentation. So that's why I'm saying I've heard this before. But the whole tree cutting thing, the entire tree tape, that's not what we talked about.
Yeah, and there's some pictures of some, we call this one the slingshot tree, because they cut this tree down, and basically it's just the Y left. And
cut the whole tree.
But the point was, why was it left there, and why did they do that in the first place?
Right.
This is more Bob Keating's thing.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, let's step back a minute. Reading has been a tree town city for 30 years.
Where did it go?
Right.
Tree City, USA.
That's gone. As a matter of fact, Bob would appreciate it if that goes back up. He told me the two presidents went up there, and I have to apologize. I thought that was George Foreman, but.
Oh, local artist. So.
Well, if their new operating policy is in conflict with their existing general permit, then they need to apply for a modified permit. We can't just read a paper and say, oh yeah, we're fine with that. We can't do that, because then they're in violation of their permit.
Well, let's have some, you know, can we start out with some comments? That would be great. I'll dig up the permit and put it on there, and let's see if things... I mean, they're going from a 5-foot cut to an 8-foot cut. Does that violate the permit that you gave them? I don't think so.
I have no idea.
Because it's usual trimming is 20% of the canopy. I mean, that's standard. You allow that. So I would think that 5 foot's not 20%, and neither is 8.
Well, if I disagree with something in there, but it's already within the existing general permit, too bad.
Yeah.
I don't want to waste my time doing that. If it's already approved,
Well, they want this approved. How do you want to proceed?
I think they need to. We need to ask them, where does this vary from the existing permit? If so, how and where? And then we will consider on a case by case basis, or a line item by line item. That's what I think. But I'd welcome any other opinion.
Well, I'm gonna still send it out. Maybe.
If you don't want to read it, don't
read it. I agree with Jamie, because I mean, if we had a starting place of an agreement, we need to make sure we don't review this plan and then make all these other comments and questions that have already been tackled or oppose or differ from drastically from what we've done before. And if they don't have a permit, then they need to file that as a permit.
Right, and under the
and operating
bylaw and regulations, because the state has allowed them to do this, so they are utility exemption. So
well, it sounds like some of the practices are infringing on what we would disapprove.
Yeah, it's always the town that stops things.
We have rationale.
All right, so I will.
Rebecca, did you want to add?
You go back to them and say, how is this different from the general permit? But if you could send it to us still, and send us the.
So we could see
if we do have the general permit.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to send both, and you can take a look. I mean, some of the general permits, I mean, haven't seen it. You guys haven't seen it. So, any comments on. The gas line coming through. Any comments on that? Any issues?
I don't know.
Someone said, I thought, Danica, you said there's something. It's not even
No, that's the new, that's a new lateral, this is existing, right?
This is maintenance, this is mowing and trimming around the existing line.
Existing, right.
And they sent a map of the existing line.
I've confused you, sorry. Now we've switched and we're talking about the new gas line coming through.
There is, but I thought it wasn't coming through anymore.
I didn't think it was, I thought they changed it.
Papers said it.
Yeah, I thought they changed it too.
We looked on the website and it still shows it's going through Reading.
Oh, well, that doesn't jive with something about the AG.
Because I remember you saying it wasn't going through Reading anymore, and so we went to the website and it shows a map going through Reading, so.
But maybe they have old documents?
But it was just that same corner, you know, up by Cedar Swamp. And if that's the case, is there any comments? Are we worried about that in any way? I mean, we don't have any vernal pools out there. It's known to be kind of an access road. It's not new territory. You know, they're working within their existing right of way. That's what I'm hearing so far.
Well, they need a wetlands permit to build this pipeline.
Yeah.
And they're preparing an EIR, correct?
They certainly are.
Then I would suggest they come and talk to us, because they should not put anything in their EIR that doesn't have a high likelihood of being permitted. So they should come and talk to us. Explain to us what they're going to do, where it's going to be, so on and so forth. That's what I would suggest. Because if they put that in the EIR and then we don't give a permit, they'd have to go back and redo that portion of the EIR, which I don't think they'd want to do. So I think they'd want to come talk to us.
If they're in a resource area. Don't they have to come to us?
Eventually they'd have to come for a permit, but they'd be smart to come to us during the EIR.
I'm very confused.
I am too,
because
I thought it was out.
So did I. But
are we sure it's in Reading? I'm not convinced that it is.
Like I said, we looked at this, me and Jesse Wilson looked at this, because I was saying that I was told that it was out of, you know, I referred to your email, and I said it was out. And she said, I just got something, and we went back and forth a few times, and we went to the website, and it shows it going through Reading still.
Okay, well then maybe a phone call needs to be.
Oh, wait. But is that the, when you were looking at those maps, were those the pre-application maps that they didn't take off
the
website?
Page.
Could be.
Yeah, maybe.
I made that mistake before.
Chuck, what I appreciate would be if you would do a follow-up call with, was it CDM? There was a letter we got last year.
Was it Econ or Tetra Tech?
No,
it wasn't Tetra Tech.
I have it at home if Rebecca doesn't have it.
I thought I printed this.
What, do you have it,
it's
Mike?
Not the, it's not Hashmont. It's not the same as this other one.
No, actually, I think it is Hatch, but it was a different.
Is it? Because I'm confusing what you're saying, Chuck, with this.
It is AECOM.
It's
AECOM. It's AECOM.
And it's out of Providence for some reason.
Yeah, it was a weird place. Yeah.
I was confusing what you were saying with this mowing notice. Because you were saying it followed a right of way. And my knowledge is they were actually going to go off the right of way because they didn't have permission to be on the right of way yet. You know, so, and I thought in near North Reading, especially up near Haverhill Street, you know, I know there's an RMLD property in North Reading that the line would go through their back, the proposed line would go through their back parking lot, and it would also go close to a small valley area where there's wetlands and there is a vernal pool. But again, that map scale was tremendous. Right. Map scale is huge, so was it within 200 feet?
Let's just get a few more facts.
Let's see if. So Chuck, let me know if you can find the phone.
that's the right of way it would.
And that's where it's going.
Go through. But it's not just there.
Does it drop back down into the road somewhere?
Yeah. Yeah, it does.
Well, it ran along.
Yeah, they really skirted the town boundaries. They just went like right on.
Good. You have to deal with it.
Are you saying we have a reputation?
No, it's just interesting to see how people draw lines.
Okay.
So regarding Tennessee Gas.
All right, I'll just have to, if you can find your notes, call you and, or just get something from you.
Yeah.
It sounds like you've looked at this.
I mean, I went to an open house in Andover. I talked to a couple of people there. I got copies of maps. I gave some stuff to Rebecca because you said you had done something similar and we talked about it.
I saw that email. Sink your teeth into this.
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't. I tried. I called the lady and she never called back. Yeah.
Okay.
And I did go on the website too.
Yeah, I thought maybe you could navigate that website a little better than me because it was like going into a black hole.
They just
threw everything up.
They dumped,
they did,
and you can't, because of the scale, you can't read where they were. It's like
you can't even read the full file name. Right. So now to move on, regarding the other cutting, I didn't have any massive issues with that.
I think we already
talked about that. Are we done with that one?
Yeah.
All right. Then what's next? I've got emergency permit 37 Collins Ave.
Yeah, it should be ratified. Michael, thank you very much for stepping up.
That was great.
I didn't even know how that happened. I'm like, who's Michael when I see it? When because I was looking at the emails and I didn't see that.
Yeah,
how that worked,
July weekend.
But it did work somehow. So this just needs to be ratified by everyone. Good job, everyone. And you you signed it, but if everyone else can sign it.
Mike, did you want to say anything about it?
So
was it discussed at the last meeting?
It was right in the edge of the resort, probably even close to the end, but there was a sewer line just clogged. They CCTV'd it, found where the clog was. They were going to excavate an access. I met with the town. We went out with town engineers. We went out and located where they should put erosion controls. And it was just going to be a half a day work, locate the blockage, clean it out, and repair the pipe.
Okay.
I took actually quite a bit of pictures in the area. Because I went right onto vacation right afterwards, I never ended up sending it to everybody.
Just out of curiosity, were they going to put a sewer dam in?
They weren't.
They weren't?
So it wasn't backing up, I guess. They just knew it was blocking. I'm not sure how.
Where are they going to put a
sewer dam? Inflatable sewer dam.
Stop the sewer so they can work on it.
Yeah.
Yes.
So when you excavate the hole, then fill up with the rest of it.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. It's just connected to this single house.
Okay.
Just a service.
Just a court.
Just tell that homeowner
doesn't
work all the time.
give him a hotel room for a night to do work.
It was interesting that it was separate from that. It was interesting because it was just a single homeowner, but it was going directly to the main line. I'm not sure why that house wasn't going to the street instead.
Oh, really?
Because the main line cuts right through, what's the resource area, that bit.
Oh, so it went to something in an easement.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
I was wondering why the digging was behind the house.
It just might be the hydraulic gradient.
Yeah.
Well,
we don't have to sign this. It only requires the chairman or the designee.
Yes.
Do we still want to sign it?
You always sign it. Usually what happens is the administrator signs it, and then the commission ratifies it. So So it says something somewhere where the commission needs to ratify it, so I would just sign it. That's basically what usually happens with these things. And you're just saying that you agree with the decision that one person made. So.
Is it 27?
Yes. Almost done. Okay. Street acceptance report?
We did that.
We did that.
No.
Bills?
I can update you, fast signs, we're gonna have our, hopefully we'll have our signs for Timonex Swamp by the end of the month.
Great.
Yeah, well.
Can we get casting signs installed at the same time?
We don't know where they are.
Oh, we lost them.
You know how much these signs are $900. 25 signs.
These are, yeah.
Collected. At the same price that they quoted, it's like only thirty something dollars a sign, it's still $900.
Incredible.
Yeah.
So yeah, let's find the casting signs and put them up.
So next, I mean, no bills?
Well, actually, hold on, if I could bring something up, Nick, that you brought up, is this Birch Meadow Master Plan. Just a little bit of history for Becky, for you, and Michael. Birch Meadow is that recreational complex right there, about the tennis courts and the high school. And we did a master plan, it's probably been 6-7 years ago. And there was a huge interest in taking Castine Field, which is a wetland, and basically filling it to make a soccer field. And we were able to prevail, and in the master plan, Castine Field would stay as is.
Mm-hmm.
They are now reviewing that master plan, so we just need to maintain vigilant that that doesn't happen. You know, because that Castine Field, not only a jurisdictional wetland, it's important in flood control, it's important in wildlife habitat. To drive by there, it's one of the best type of cattail marshes in town.
Is it the top of the Aberdeen?
It is.
Okay.
Pretty much the top. The actual top's on the football field. It's just below the top. And so anyway, we just need to maintain vigilance as they revise that.
Do you happen to know the schedule for that field and when it opens up for play and not, or if it does
it's
at all?
It's just based on conditions, weather conditions. And the recreation. John Fudo makes a decision based on what the weather is, now what the soil is.
I mean, regardless of what they do with that master plan, it's still jurisdictional.
Absolutely.
So.
Yep. Yeah.
We actually are as a remiss letting them cut the field, but that was kind of compromised. No fill, but you can cut the grass, all except for that cattail area on either side of the field.
And once we get those signs up, it's going to be.
If we can find them.
For sure.
It's usually the mucky ground that prevents them to go any closer. So.
Yeah, they've gotten stuck in there with the lawnmowers one once.
So. Jamie, do you know? So that online survey was to get more current public feedback. Was it, I think, and so that kind of tells me it's the master plan might be in the process of being revisited, revised. Have you heard anything about that?
It is in the process of being revisited. I know that.
And what town entity is
the recreation? John.
Okay.
John.
Has anybody been from conservation been approached?
No, but
for that?
We should be on that committee again. There's
yes,
board
absolutely.
Okay. I'll send John an email.
Good.
All right. Great. Anything else at this
no.
point?
No.
Okay, then let's.
let's bring up the topic of elections. I think we have all members present, so we can have a good thorough discussion. We, according to the town bylaws, we, and I'd like to think this isn't true, but I think we are one of the only, well, the only board I happen to know of, and maybe true or not, that is paying attention to the deadline and the kind of the letter of the law.
The selectmen do.
Do they?
Absolutely.
Okay, all right. So, okay, so we, according to town regulations, not conservation regulations, but town regulations, we are on the dock to re-elect a chair and vice chair. I'll just start out by saying, I've enjoyed being chair. I've enjoyed learning a little bit more, a little bit better, how the town has been working. It's been interesting, it's been challenging. Chuck and I have put together we've drafted a presentation to give to the DPW to extend the conversation of what can be done in wetlands and what can't be done in wetlands, kind of starting to kind of crack open the door with the theory that, you know, increased communication and a little bit of outreach might, I mean, I'm not saying it's a guarantee, but might start to almost gain a little bit more trust between what they're doing and what we expect that they do, and hopefully get them a little bit more on board with thinking, with considering that wetlands are something that need to be paid attention to, and drainage areas and all those practices need special attention and have special practices, and there are reasons behind that. It's not just that we're trying to be, you know, irascible or cause them job grief or strife, so, or get them in trouble. So we're in the beginning of doing that. We've been talking about it for a while. We've been having conversations with DPW supervisors and assistant supervisors to get their feedback a little bit about how the what they thought of some of the topics and some of the pictures. And, anyway, it'd be good. I would definitely be grateful for the opportunity to continue doing that, either as chair or as vice chair, you know, so that I can kind of close out that project at least, and be the same face that they've seen before. And, you know, like anything, I report back to everybody, you know, how it went, and, you know, everyone's invited to join in the process as you're able and willing, and, you know.
I think that's great. I hope you'll stick with it and follow through.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
Yeah. So, is anybody else interested in? Go ahead.
Since we say, again, the only thing I have to say is I hope that the chair can be elected for 2 years. I think I make this request before. It's just so hard to continually have a new one. I've talked to the selectmen. They're not hoping that you change every year. They just want it to be voted on.
I mean, I think we certainly elect the same chairman twice, but
yeah,
it needs to, they can't be elected for 2 years.
Well, maybe the person that becomes the chairman considers a position for 2 years, not just one.
We may re-elect Anika.
It's true.
So, are we going to open the field for nominations for chair and then do vice chair?
Sure.
And
sure. I'd like to hear.
I'd like to, first of all, I'd like to nominate Brian as chair. And before we ask for a second, I'd like to just say that I think Anika's been a very good chair, that Anika started as a new member and sat in the wings for a couple of few years, then took over as chair and rose right to the surface. And Brian was able to come in as her understudy as vice chair. And that the way we have operated in the past is to have a rotating chair with a vice chair, learn the ropes, and then move in, and that gives everybody a chance to be a full participant in the process. So with that as background, not only do I think that approach works, and that's why I think it's a good idea, and why I would like to see Brian as chair, but also he's done a great job, he's put in the time, and I think it would be good to let his skill set show.
Brian, do you have any interest in being chair? Do you have any? Do you want to pitch? Do you want to? How do you want to?
Well, I think it's my turn. I've been a member for 5 or 6 years now. I lost track. I think I've been here long enough that, I mean, I still learn new nuances when I go to different meetings on the other side of the table, dealing with commissions and how they deal with things differently than we do. But I think I know the regulations pretty well. And I think it's time. You know, I understand it's going to require a bit more time than I currently give to the commission, and I'm prepared to do that. I actually made a decision a couple months ago I was just re-sworn in tonight for another term. Another term of abuse, apparently. And so I decided that either I was going to continue or I was going to move on to another commission or board, or I was just not going to volunteer any longer with, you know, this term being, and I made the decision that I was going, and if I was going to stay, then I knew that I would probably, I think it's my turn to give back to the commission and that with that respect. So that's the reason why do want to be considered the chair.
That's interesting. You know, my thought about your, and Nikki, you've done a great job. Have you been chair for 2 years now, or one?
Yeah.
Two, yeah.
I guess.
It's
all a blur.
It's a wonderful blur. My only thought, Brian, was, you know, you have other commitments, your job, and I know that you have to go to a lot of other meetings at night, and
I was
a little concerned, but you've kind of allayed my thoughts and my fears on that.
And there will be times when, for instance, today I was looking at, I don't think I'm going to have to go, Groveland has their hearings on the exact same night that we do, they have one hearing a month, and it's the second Wednesday of the month.
Yeah.
So if I ever have to go to a Groveland meeting, then I have to miss this meeting. A lot of the other meetings are on Tuesdays and Thursdays. One town, I can't remember which one, is on Monday. But there may be conflicts if I have to attend a meeting for work.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I have to say, it's been my experience that I've been able to reach you, you know, more often than not to sort of do last minute counsel and, you know, idea thought sharing about specific projects. And I've done that on purpose,
mm-hmm.
because you are the vice chair. You know, and if I've got a concern about a project or I just need a sounding board in particular, I will go to you as vice chair to also give you a sense of what I've been doing as chair. You know, like, here's something that's before us. It's not anything. It's, you know, it's not a permit. It's not this. It's just this. I was thinking of tackling it this way. What are your thoughts? You know, and that's been valuable. Another thing I wanted to mention is that in terms of another initiative, I was really, really hoping to continue out. And I'd offered to do this just as a member of the commission, is really encourage us to, as a commission, to have one strategic planning meeting a year. It'd be that one additional meeting, or maybe instead of a hearing, two meetings a month, one of them is over at Matera, and we can post it as public, but it's a slightly more informal setting where everybody basically reviews areas of the Wetlands Protection Act and aspects of conservation that they're particularly interested in, that maybe they want to take a little special niche corner in, out of, so that, like, let's say stormwater or drainage analysis or, you know, plants or, you know, for me, I'm curious about educational outreach. It'd be great to have a commission member who's got some educational connections, so that we could do a little bit more cooperative outreach with schools and stuff like that, and the public. So, you know, that's, I think everyone's very busy, but it'd be really valuable to develop all of us, you know, as a commission, and move that forward. And just, I think I learn more just from conservation discussions here than most of the time I'm reviewing the projects at home, you know. So it's really helpful. And it doesn't have to be a long meeting. And it can have refreshments.
I was going to say food.
It could be long meetings.
Yeah, yeah.
Just some wine.
Perhaps you could have some choice beverages and, you know.
Yeah,
we're all adults. I think we can handle that.
I have been to meetings where the commission people had, like, the bottle of gin on the table.
Well,
the Berkshires. Oh, no, I'm serious.
Well, I don't think we have to go that far, you know. And especially as we posted a public meeting, and if anybody's watching tonight, you know, I'm sure they're going to be like, hey, I mean, that strategic planning meeting, let's get down there and see what they're really doing at the cabin. Yeah, so, Mike, I don't know if you had, I know you, this is third, fourth meeting for you.
Yeah, so, I mean, as a new member, you know, I'm learning all the commissioners still. I've certainly had a chance to speak with Anika probably more and get her insight more than any of the other commissioners at this point, because I had met with her even prior to joining the commission.
Yeah.
So just from my perspective, I do have, just more of a understanding and comfort of where your approach is and where you see the commission going. And I don't have as, you know, I'm still learning the other commissioners.
Okay, are we supposed to take a vote or something?
Yeah, I mean, that's what we're supposed to do.
A second, I don't think it was seconded.
No, we were just talking. So, I will.
Is Ryan unopposed?
I'm sorry, what?
I'm just.
What?
No one else wants to make this interesting?
You're
a straw candidate or something?
You're a pot star.
Okay, I could do a bully pulpit and vote against it and say I'm going for a third year's chair. You know, especially because the first 2 years. We weren't really, by a year and a half, we were all going, shouldn't we have voted? Like, are you still chair? I don't know. Maybe. Yes. No. I can stir the pot a little and say.
We're going to vacate all of our
I got this experience.
Year,
you know, put me in again.
And we're really not chair.
Ooh, I was chair. So there's a motion. Has it been seconded?
I'll second.
Okay. All those in favor? Opposed?
Abstained?
What?
Oh, 2-2. Awesome. Kidding me.
How did we do that?
No, it passed. There were two affirmative and no negative.
Is that how the vote goes?
Yeah.
Is that Robert's rules?
It's a majority.
I mean, I think it should.
Well, let's document that and have it as is in the minutes. Let's call it done. Vice President, Vice Chair, please. I would like to
moving
nominate
on.
Myself
should
as
I
Vice.
Should I have voted for myself? I mean,
yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah.
If you...
you should have voted.
Well, you know what? You made a pitch for yourself.
I know.
Now you're saying, now you're not going to vote for yourself?
Well, I mean... I well, I... would vote for myself, I didn't know if it was proper.
Oh.
Sure.
Definitely proper.
Yeah, so, do we wanna revote?
Sure.
Can we revote?
We have to wait a year.
Is that a motion?
What?
Wait a year.
What?
What'd you say?
This is that 2 year you were looking for, right?
Yeah.
Only 2 year.
Second year. I apologize.
Would you like to rescind your abstention?
I'm gonna rescind my abstention.
All right, that's 3-2.
And change that to, change that to an affirmative.
It's 3-0-2.
3-0-2, yeah.
The chair will acknowledge that. Okay, then I will vote, I propose to be, to be vice chair. Any seconds, anyone?
Second that.
Okay, all in favor?
Wait,
I'm ready to vote.
I'd like to nominate Becky as vice chair. I think that, to give another member, a chance to learn and move into the leadership role would be good. I think Becky's only been on the commission this time for less than a year, but she was on it before.
And before that.
So I think that she would make a good vice chair, and then be in a position to move into chair when Brian feels his time is done.
So that's one path. Rebecca, do you have any interest or?
Yeah, I do, and that would kind of give me a kickstart to really learn the Reading bylaw, which I'm not really up on, and you know, get back into the Massachusetts law a bit more.
Okay, comments, questions? Anybody have any?
Oh, this is
good. So I also, because, and you know, no counter to your qualifications or you even being nominated, but I also want to nominate myself as vice chair, just to have the authoritative position to move that presentation forward with DPW. I've been intimately involved in that, and if I'm going, you know, that's something that Chuck and I have spent easily 5 to 10 additional hours of our own time developing, and it's something that I would like to see followed through on and finished.
I think it would be great if you'd stick with it and finish it. I think that's appropriate. You have the background. You know the people. I think it's imperative.
Yeah,
regardless.
Well.
And that there's no need to be vice chair to do that. And plus, in my opinion, I think it's important to spread out the duties, the obligations, and the workload. And so, if you take and stick with that presentation, that would be your contribution. And then Becky, her contribution, her time would be spent. And the tutelage of Brian being the vice chair. So it tends to spread things out, give everybody a chance, and that's why I think, I hope you'll stay with that initiative.
I think with that crowd, my suspicion is, my read, and whether it's accurate or not, my read is they will put on a different set of years if there's an authority title associated with me being present at those presentations.
We can always create a title for it. Outreach coordinator.
I would have to say, when we redid the bylaws, we formed an ad hoc committee to do the bylaws.
Right.
And I was chair of that ad hoc committee, and for better or for worse, I got
everyone
all
knew.
The attention from the selectmen.
Everyone knew you were the chair of the ad hoc committee.
I didn't need any other title.
Right. Well, I'm not proposing we revise the regulations again. I think that would be something. So, okay. Well, it's out there. Any more discussion or no? Big sigh.
I'd like to second if I can.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll give anybody to the second one.
Okay, okay, all those, go ahead.
I'll second you and Mika as well. I don't know if that's the same thing.
Yeah, I think you already did.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, so all those, so we'll do Becky first. All those in favor of Becky being chair, raise your hand.
Vice chair.
Vice chair, thanks. That's getting late. Opposed? Okay, all right, well, there it is.
Well, actually, it opposed, it's all those in favor of the other nominee.
Yep, there it is. All right. Then my last job as chair, formally, is to thank Chuck for all his time with me.
It sounds like you're still going to be around doing this presentation, so.
Well, fun. I'll stay for that. So, okay. So is there any other business?
Do we have to do minutes?
Minutes.
Yep,
oh, right.
Minutes.
Let's do the minutes. June 24. Is that the minutes we're doing?
Yep.
All right.
Okay.
Did you? I don't think I was here for that. And that was Allison's last night.
What is this?
So I'm going to abstain from voting on the minutes.
Okay.
No, you weren't here.
Nope.
Just the first RDA, 87 Avalon Road, third paragraph, second line, which is has, just take out the has, and the next line there, put an is after that. And then the last sentence, she also observed that the deck was in poor condition. And then on the second page, continue notice of intent for 306 Main Street. Hearing for Pizza World is continue until next meeting on June 8th and then July 22nd, 2015. It's actually when they came back in, because we didn't have July 8th.
Yeah, but it was continued until July. We just didn't do it.
I understand, but for the record, wouldn't you want to know when they did come back in?
I don't think we want to for the minutes of that meeting.
Yeah, it'll be in the minutes from tonight.
All right.
So it will be in the record.
And then the next page, Dana's Properties, 1, 2, 3rd paragraph, third line, the end of it, bordering vegetated, not vegetative.
While we're on there, is there any more news on there, Chuck?
Yeah, Jamie from Dana's Properties came in and I spoke with him about a toned down version of what they want to do, which would be the stormwater system in between the two roads. You know what I'm talking about? Yes, on the entrance road. So they want to still cut down all the trees on that. They want to cut down some trees across the street from that, but only going in 5 to 7 feet. They want to take out the invasives down at the corner. But I think the one thing that we have to be worried about, or to make sure that we understand fully, is they also want this new permit to have a ongoing operation and maintenance plan that allows them to remove invasives, which according to the, you know, what I'm getting, is going to be trees too.
So they still plan on filing?
Yeah. They're going to file something, but wasn't the direction from the commission, if they were going to take care of that detention pond in the center, that was going to be an RDA every day of the week?
Well, we thought that if that was the only thing they were doing, it might qualify as an RDA.
Right. This, what I just described, is no way ecological restoration project. There's absolutely, that's all up and dry. That's at least buffer, okay, that what I'm talking about, except for, you know, the frags down the end. And we always allow that. You know, that's good work. So it's like I said, it's just that management plan, and they want to they want to take their entrance, their Ford, their Pacer of an entrance, and they want to turn it into a Mercedes. So I asked them for, well, they do. They want to make that thing manicured in those areas that I just talked about. So we're going to need a plan, and we're going to need some sort of vegetation management plan, too. So that's what they're going to come in with. We need to know what they're going to take down, what it's going to look like, and how they're going to maintain it.
So this is not a restoration project?
Well, they're not working in the wetlands for anything that matters, except for the invasive removal.
So they wouldn't have to file with the, put the notice in the environmental monitoring?
This is more of a normal maintenance based on the buffer zone of a property next to a wetland.
I've gotten a lot of calls from Reading citizens on this project, so there's a fair amount of interest in that.
What have been the nature of the feedback?
People that want a trail, people don't want any trees cut, people that think Dennis Properties is just trying to hoodwink everybody, people that would like the invasives gone. I mean, it's kind of
all over the place.
But certainly it's a visible project with some interest.
Are you getting those calls as a town meeting member, or as a with people knowing you're on conservation?
Oh, I think just as a good old guy.
Oh my!
Probably conservation commission would be my guess, but they're people I know. I haven't gotten any.
So it doesn't mean that John Dick is off the project. It's still going to be presented by Hayes, by Hancock. Like I said, I think we all understand that this new version of the project, downsized, is certainly something that the commission, could handle under a notice of intent. So that was the direction I gave them. I asked them for those plans. I asked them for, they identify the trees just like we did before, but we're not going to need a lot of those steps that are taken in the ecological restoration. So it seems better in a way. I mean, you guys drive in there all the time? The trees are so high around that sign. And then it's just gone wild.
It has.
There.
It's really not
a good looking resource area.
No.
And I don't mean that from a ornamental value. I mean from a resource area value.
Do we need to look back into the order of conditions that allowed this in the first place? That detention pond, to see what's required or not, or is it just we're just going to start from scratch?
It's not a bad idea.
I think a lot of work went into that, and there's got to be.
Well, it did, but then whoever decided trees are going to remain, so I didn't think that was really carved out and nailed down in the order of conditions. I thought that you had to provide, some mitigation. And I think that's what I'll find. But I wasn't sure, just by the look of this area, that it was really thought about too much.
Okay. I think as a general practice, it's always good to go back to the agreed upon plan that's attached to the deed and, something that everyone's already agreed to.
Okay, well, we'll attack that when we get an order or a permit in.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No,
we're still doing the minute
changes.
Oh,
yeah, right. Yeah, there are just a couple more on the second to last page. Dennis is proposing to file a notice of intent, and then administrator's report, first line.
Wait, where's the?
Discovered an area in of, just take out in.
So they're proposing to file an ecological restoration notice of intent. That's what it's called.
That's what it is?
That's what they were doing. Now they're not.
Yeah, they're not.
Yeah.
Or they might change their mind again.
So did they formally withdraw
They don't have anything filed. They just came in and then it came down to the fee.
So some of the numbers that he got from.
I think he filed an RDA and we gave a.
We gave him a positive.
Threw him for the loop. He, you know, this was a, I thought he said it's a $2,000 to $5,000 project. And now we're up to $60,000, they're backing off from it, so they're, you know, they were. That's a big difference, but I don't think I ever would have told him it was $5,000 worth of work. I mean, permitting, my God.
I believe he told him that. I don't believe, because he's not that.
They originally said $40,000 to $50,000.
$40,000 to $50,000, yeah.
And then he said, and it may cost $100,000. You know what I mean? I'm just like, oh, by the way, it may just cost $100,000.
Surprise.
It's like, yeah, that sounds about right.
Well, maybe it was on the initial cold call that John picked up the phone on, there would be a $5,000 project that he said. I'm not sure, but that's what
maybe
he said.
Maybe his fee would be $5,000. That I could believe.
Yeah.
That's low, but I can
that's
believe
low,
that.
Yeah, that's
but the construction cost,
no
way,
way.
$5,000.
Well,
you
in case $5,000, they came a tree.
Yeah.
Well, going over
exactly,
there, but, I mean,
right.
I thought once a year, the only thing I thought out of our little conversation is once a year the team's going to go into that wetland area and they're going to pluck out everything and trim, keep the trees trimmed up. So that's still happening. So that's the operation and maintenance plan. That's probably the thing that needs the most scrutiny in this upcoming notice of intent, just to make sure we agree with everything in it.
Yeah.
And there's those catalpas still, they want to remove them.
We done with the minutes? This was the last item. The minutes, did anybody?
I have no more comments.
I'm out of this discussion because
yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah,
did we vote and finalize it?
No, we didn't vote.
Motion?
Make a motion to vote to finalize the minutes.
Amended?
Yes, as amended.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor? Opposed? No. Any other matters? No. Okay.